Okay, so we'll begin with a brief, very brief
catch-up or just a report on how NPTEL online certification is being received. Some numbers, basically of the previous runs of courses, to give you a perspective of where we are, and hopefully that's interesting to enough of you. After that, we'll go into specifics on running courses and details of what you have to do. Okay. Anyway, this side I'll skip. So the NPTEL YouTube channel crossed 200 million views a few months back. It was a big achievement, I think. But interestingly, the views here do not include the recent videos and all that, the online courses, which are actually very important. We don't count that into this, no?
Yes, unfortunately.
Yeah, so we have to figure out how to count it. So all these are big numbers, 1,000 plus courses, 20,000 plus video hours, YouTube subscription, this, that. It's one of the most visible education channels in the world, no doubt about it. It's something one can be proud about. And even I think somebody else was mentioning that in terms of multi-institutional projects, in terms of projects by IITs themselves, just joint projects by several IITs, this should definitely rank as one of the most successful ones in the past so many years. I think that's great to see. And since 2014, we've been doing this model of online courses followed by proctored exam and giving a certificate. From March 2014, we started. It's been more than 2.5 years now. And we've come quite a ways. Still, there's lot more that can be done. Hopefully, it's interesting. For those of you who have never done this before, there is a fundamental difference between a campus course that many of us are used to and an open online course. The first big difference is anybody enrolls in an open online course. They just come to the web page. Jayanthan is here. Believe me, 90% of the people who probably click on enroll wouldn't know what algebra you're talking about or what commutative algebra means, etc. They would just click. That is to be expected. It's not unusual for this kind of a thing. But then, after a first or second week, you would know the real thing. People will get used to it. So do expect that kind of a thing. Don't be surprised by it. It's there. Another significant difference is recognition mechanisms. They are evolving. We are giving certificates. We are working very closely with colleges to do credit transfer, etc. All of that will go a long way in recognition as well. So a lot of differences are there. But at the same time, it's being adopted by a lot of people all across the country. Several colleges are coming forward to put their kids through this. So it's a very positive thing in that respect. So one question that's often asked is, a lot of portals all across the world, why should NPTEL do something? These are some of the unique things we do, which adds value in the Indian context. Of course, we have faculty who know the Indian system, who know students here, what they would have learned, what they wouldn't have learned, so that we can tune our courses better. We have accent, which is more understandable by a lot of Indians, I think. And we offer a proctored exam with the certification, which carries value, which I think, again, is something unique. At the cost at which we offer it is much, much lesser than anybody in the world. And we engage with colleges. That's a huge thing. I think some of you were here on Saturday morning when their college representatives had come. The CLT was full. You could see so many people asking questions. There was a suggestion for courses. We had a small section called suggestion for courses. It just wouldn't end. They were going on and on and on with so many course titles. It was an amazing event with a lot of energy, and it was very nice to see. And we time the courses along with the college semesters. A lot of faculty write these exams. About 10% of people who write these exams are faculty. In the last July semester, some 3,700 faculty wrote exams. So it's a huge number. So it's being used for faculty training. It's having tremendous impact with colleges. At least the colleges that are active, that connect with us, it's going a long ways. And also we offer courses in so-called boring disciplines also. We don't shy away from that. We do rigorous courses, full-fledged courses in all disciplines. Any discipline you take, a typical portal would usually do computer science, maybe a few general interest courses. We do a lot of courses. Everything has value in our country with so many colleges there. We engage with industries, with authorities, influence policy, all these kind of things we do try to do. So the portal itself, for those of you who are seeing it for the first time, the portal has several parts. The main part is the course content, which is your video lecture. And another important part is the discussion forum, where students ask questions and you have to answer. And another very important part is the assignment. Assignments, various types, subjective type, programming assignments for those of you who want to do that. And also mentors from colleges can be part of the portal, they can mentor students, etc. But to me, the three main things are course content, video lectures, assignments, and forum. Okay, so I'll talk in more detail about how to run these things, but this is just an introductory one for people who don't know. After the online course is over, we do a certification exam. That's how our exam halls look. For those of you who probably gone for GATE exam or so, you would have seen how it works. The same partner runs the exam. And after the exam, for those of those students who pass, there is a passing criteria. For those students who pass, we give a certificate. That's how it works. And you know, sometimes we have partners whom we associate with for giving certificates, etc. It's interesting. So in terms of numbers, this is again, if you come look at the bottom, in March we started with one course. In the July to September semester, just the last semester, we had 73 courses. In July to October, we had 31 courses. So from one course, we have moved on to more than 100 courses in a single semester. So this shows definitely that faculty are believing in this. And not only that, students, of course, across the country are believing in this. So we've finished 225 courses. It's a big number in little more than 2 years. And that's tremendous. And in January, again, we are looking at least 100 courses or more. In fact, 130 is what the number is. We'll count the chickens after they're hatched, but that's 130 is the proposed number as of now. And once again, like I mentioned, as far as disciplines are concerned, we have done 226 courses. That's a huge number. And you can see it covers the entire spread. I mean, anything you want to name, it would be there. Of course, computer science and humanities, social sciences tends to be the largest. It's because it cuts across various disciplines. But you also have other areas. I mean, if you take civil engineering, there are 15 courses. And believe me, civil engineering courses are very, very popular. I mean, so many colleges like civil engineering courses because they don't have teaching there. Yes?
These are unique courses?
No, some of them include reruns. Yeah, two, out of 226, 199 are unique. So I mean, the big departments tend to have lots of courses, but anyway, that's how it works. And in terms of faculty, where they come from, IIT Madras has been leading in a big way, but I think soon other people will catch up. Other IITs are coming in. We also work with a few institutes outside of IITs with courses, but that's the number. Once again, it reaffirms what I said about NPTEL offering courses across the spectrum, not just sticking to what would be popular, etc. In terms of numbers, once again, there's been phenomenal growth in every measurable number that you look at. There's been very impressive growth. Starting with one course to 225 courses, we've had more than 10 lakh course enrollments. And some of you may know that the government does not allow us to publicize. We're not supposed to take out press articles, etc., for some bizarre reason. Don't ask me why. But in spite of all that, the numbers are growing, and I think we will continue to grow in January as well. We are engaging with so many colleges directly. Many of them are interested. In the last semester, you can see more than 2.5 lakh students were in the courses in the July-September time, and close to 1.5 lakhs. So that's a huge number. Not all of it translates into exam registration. So you don't have to be worried. We won't have lakhs of students writing your exams. Okay, so that won't happen. The number of people who write exams is usually of the order of 5 to 10% of the number that enrolls. So you don't have to panic too much. But still, the number of people writing exams is also becoming large. It's becoming very, very big in some sense. So whenever numbers grow up like this, we have to be very mindful of quality. I think that's the first thing I would emphasize here. Quality in various senses, you know, in terms of the correctness of the content, the way it's delivered, how good the video is done. Are there any bugs? Are there any typos in the text you put out? Because it's so visible, right? Everybody is seeing it. So even a typo just reflects very badly. They'll say, oh, this is IIT, how can they do this? I mean, this tends to happen a lot. So I would definitely urge you to look at every single content you put out, everything you put out, particularly assignment questions. Any mistake in assignment question, any mistake in exam questions reflects really, really badly. So you need that diligence to make sure quality is not affected. The numbers have been huge. So 65,000 people have paid 1,000 rupees and enrolled in registered for exams. That's in just 2.5 years. It's in terms of even just money coming in, it's a huge amount of money for handling certificates going out. I don't know, if you step into the office, you'll see some huge piles of certificates. We tried convincing everyone that maybe you should shift to an electronic certificate. Nobody is willing to accept it. They all want the printed version. And it's just being able to scale is really, really hard. More than 30,000 people wrote exams last semester. We are forecasting close to 50,000 for January. Okay, that's a big number. We are trying very hard to match that. And like I said, we are not really pushing it or advertising in a big way. This number is just growing just by word of mouth through colleges, which is again a very interesting thing to
see. I am member board of studies with NIT teaching. In the recent Senate, we approved that NPTEL courses can be also credited.
Oh, wow. Right? IIT Madras also we did, yeah.
NPTEL, I mean, NIT also agreed upon. Now, there is a big botheration here. They say that there should be an authentic proof that the person has undergone this course of any title. There should be an authentic proof that you have to register for these courses and you must have enrolled. There are two ways by which you can do this authenticity. One, either NPTEL introduces certificate of participation, which is actually, I don't know whether the motive is. Second part is, there is a huge drop, less than 5% who take the exam.
Yes.
What can we do to do this? I mean, improve this. Because this is a very great botheration.
Yeah.
In fact, if I try to, if it in a own class, if people only audit the course, we are not actually motivated. Only if they take the exam, we are slightly motivated. Because, you know, the entire portal of discussion forum is kept busy for the whole semester. And at the end, you don't get a person to take an exam. So, this actually puts a lot of pain to the course coordinator as well as NPTEL also.
Yeah, yeah.
What methods are we actually? I am involved in NPTEL for the past few years. I have done 10 courses. So, I have a right at least to ask you as a coordinator what route we are going to follow to improve the examination registrations.
Percentage. Okay.
Percentage. Because this is very, very pathetic. This is actually not giving me an end. The fruit is not coming out.
Yeah.
Simply taking a course and not examining it or become not an examinee, you're not giving me a credit actually, because I will only be happy when a person credits my course and transfer it further for his education. Why is this not happening?
Okay, so I'll answer the question in 2-3 ways. The first thing is about authenticating the person who comes and does the course. So we cannot authenticate the person who did the online course. It's just not possible. We're not trying to do it. We can only authenticate the person who wrote the exam. And that we do. He has to give an ID, we look at the ID, we verify all that, and then we give a certificate only to that person, and only that person should be allowed to do credit transfer, not the person who just enrolled in the online course. So that takes care of the authentication part. Secondly, as far as dropouts are concerned, I really think this big lack of numbers, you shouldn't even look at, you shouldn't even notice. The number to really look at is the number of people who submitted your first assignment, or let's say the first and second week's assignment. That I think is the real number. I mean, everything else is just a fluff, you know. I mean, people just coming in, you don't even count it. In fact, I would be happy if we don't even report this course enrollment number, but it just says that people are aware, so many people are aware that this is going on, okay? So, that number, if you see, the drop-off is not very significant. It's not very significant. That's really in your hands, and we've seen across courses, that number is pretty good. The number of people who write exams divided by the number of people who submitted the first assignment is not a very bad number. That's one. And the other interesting feature we are seeing is, if you look at the enrollments and registrations from local chapter colleges, where the college is also involved, that number is dramatically higher, extremely higher. In fact, 75% of people who write exams are coming through the local chapters. So if you add to that the credit transfer mechanism, you make that, you know, people can actually do credit these courses in their colleges, combined with all these things, I think we will get a much more significant number of people writing our exams. That I think will happen. It's in the works, but you know, credit, the notion of credit itself is new to our university system. I mean, we've been in IIT, so we know, we understand credit a lot. You just step out of IITs a little bit, credit is new. It's very, very new. The CBCS in universities is absolutely new. Many universities don't have it. They don't understand that. So, slowly people are beginning to understand that. We are trying to push that. Those are the policy decisions we are trying to influence. I think it will happen. We should work towards it. And if you focus on the numbers, the way I said it, it's much better. Don't look at this big fluff of people who are clicking and enrolling. Yes.
Maybe I'll also add that you can see the current run, the immediate run, we have, I think, about 25,000 certificates we have sent out for that order. Already more than, you know, 3 times our students strength in campus.
So that's another way to look at the numbers, that you're already reaching, as a faculty, you're already reaching a number which is significantly higher than what you would reach in your class. In fact, for some of us, based on the course we are offering, in a single run, we are offering getting the number of students who finish the course, successfully complete the course, is what we would otherwise take 10 years to, you know, reach inside the campus. So therefore, the reach is significant. And therefore, I think that's a good
That's thing another way of viewing it. It's not insignificant. So this is a kind of a negative way to look at the numbers, I think. I mean, there are various positive ways of viewing it. That's what we're trying to point.
The other point which is not there in our slides is also that out of 32,000 people, we had about 4,000 faculty members take up the courses.
I mentioned that. So all these things add up. So you have to view it carefully. But yes, I mean, it's nice to have a control group enrolling in your course. It will be nicer to do that, but then that's not the philosophy of this, you know. You just put it out openly there. People just go click.
See, as you're saying, and Andrew said, we are having a lot of college chapters.
Hmm.
So you can share this information of the college chapter nodal coordinator to the course coordinators of the internal courses this January. We can always try to reach the chapter.
Yeah, sure.
We find them.
Sure.
We go for GET duty, we go for JEE duty.
Very much.
We can use that path and involve them directly. So this can promote more people to register for the exams.
The point was apparently the 5-10% course completion is the standard.
And in
my opinion, actually, this ability to let them click and join without any other barrier is actually a positive.
Yeah, some people view it like that.
I don't view it as
But then I think his point is he's not able to interact with the people who are likely to register for the exam and then give them something more, maybe interact with them, push them a little bit and then motivate them. So that is what he is saying is missing. So through local chapters, we can arrange for that. We can see what are the colleges which are interested.
The other thing was, I think end of the semester, there was a video session. I wonder for people who are or faculty and local chapters who are more interested,
Exactly.
Useful to have a middle of the semester. So 4 week and 8 week.
The live session, you mean? Okay. We can try that. The live sessions are always.
Overhead with respect to scheduling and management.
This
is going to be crazy.
Yeah. Because when you say middle of the semester, imagine 100 courses, 100 question papers, we're pushing it to the exam partner. Believe me, it's just a nightmare in our office. I'm saying there are so many other things that are going on. If you add on to this, the burden of organizing these sessions, it's pretty hard. We'll try to figure out how to do it. If it is smooth enough that we are not involved too much, we can. So nobody offers exams other than us. So you can only look at completion in whatever way they define it. But it's the same percentage, I think. 2 to 5, yeah. I think. So I'm moving on. So in terms of people, so this looks a little older to me, but anyway, number of people who are enrolling, a large number is students. There is a small fraction which is faculty, etc. Number of people who register for exams also are like that. We do a lot of things for toppers. Toppers in the course, we give priority. We put them up in our portal, nptel.ac.in. This is also a place where people can verify their certificates, etc. So here is another thing you can do. You can reach and connect with certified students. So this is possible. So in case you're running a project for which you want to hire people, maybe you have done some course here, you can advertise the project positions on this portal to specified students. So you can say people who did well in these courses, I would like to offer them an opportunity to get an interview for a project position in case they are interested. So this is also something that you can promote with your colleagues, saying in case somebody is looking for a project hiring. In fact, it's quite hard to hire good people into our project. So this is a way in which you can reach out to people also. So this is, I think, has been one of the unimaginably big successes of our initiative, the local chapter colleges. The number has crossed 700 now. Every week we get 5 requests for adding a local chapter. But of course, even though there are 700, not all of them are going to be very, very active. The number of active colleges comes to around 400 or so, which is still a fairly big number across the country. And you can see every state is represented. I think that Andaman and Nicobar is actually one. It's not three, no. There's only one college there, which is a local chapter. And all across the country, there's so many of them. And you can see they form a significant fraction of our course enrollments. and exam registration. So both of them are very, very significant. And there are mentors from these colleges who participate in the portal. So for local chapters, we have a lot of visibility in our portals. It's been, I wish you had come for the Saturday's meeting. They were all here, they were all quite excited. In fact, we now do a rating and ranking of local chapters and all based on their performance in our courses. They really like it. We also partner with industry. So in case you have an industry contact who wants to work with us, we do a variety of things with them. In fact, while you're offering this course, if there are a group of industry which are interested in interacting with you more, you can get into a CCE sort of course with them separately, and you can run this course for everybody, and you can do something additional for the industry participants and charge them whatever you want directly, and they can write our exams as well. All of these are possible, so please do explore all those possibilities. Yes.
Yeah, in that context, if you have a professional body meeting in your area coming up sometime soon, if you can let us know at that point, and if you can help us get a small slot in it, we'll make a short presentation on this, on how the industry can actively participate in various ways. I mean, they can support students, existing students, they can send their staff for the scores, they can go off, whatever. We'll discuss that with them, but we'd like to present it to them.
Yeah. That's also, I think, in the industry bodies have been very positive. So this is happening a lot. So for instance, there is a course that NIT Kharagpur faculty is offering. This is an open course, it's offered on NPTEL, but HCL is interested in partnering with them. So what he has done is he's adding on some components to for that, like face-to-face interaction with the HCL employees. And they will do this open online course. And on top of that, there's a separate CCE course for which there is an additional payment from HCL to that faculty member, and he does some additional content on top of that. So you can do such things, it's possible. So please do explore such possibilities.
Andrew, okay. I have a question about the local chapters. You mentioned three for Delhi. Could you tell us which are these institutions or colleges in Delhi?
So I don't remember off the top of my right now, but I can have it emailed to you. Bharti will write an email to you with the complete list. So we have, over the years, over the last 2 years or so, we've come up with a set of best practices which I think are good to remind people. I think some of you might already have your course content ready, but nevertheless, it's good to see what we are saying. I think first, you should have a target audience in mind, a group of people who you think would be interested in this course. So even for preparing course content, I think that makes that's important. So you should keep this target audience in mind, and you have to, as far as possible, have the course content self-contained. I think that's also extremely useful, because you don't know what people are. There are people of multiple backgrounds. It's good to target to as large a audience as possible. And the second point, I cannot stress more fully, you have to be very organized and you have to plan the course completely. So for instance, the course content has to go out at exactly regular intervals. Every week on Monday morning, the course content has to go out. And this, I think, is extremely important. I mean, you'll see, maybe in the first time it might be okay, but the second week, third week and all, you have to really absolutely have the thing working on schedule. Because like I said, the numbers are big, and people, there'll be colleges in will be waiting to download the content. The moment it's released, they'll download it, then they'll release it in their local networks, they'll show it to their students. They're really banking on that. Because first of all, they'll have a setup where their faculty first watch it some 2-3 times and then put it out for students and explain it. So if you delay it, everything goes wrong there. It's absolutely important that you have the content out Monday morning without fail. Every week. It's very, very important.
Andrew,
I cannot stress that.
What's the time on Monday morning? What's the time?
I think let's say 8 o'clock.
Schedule, the role of the teaching assistant is very critical.
Yeah, yeah. Extremely important.
Because faculty will often, you know, record the stuff and they think it is already set up. But there will be some minor thing that has not been done, like, you know, you just hit a button saying we go from private to public or whatever it is. And then in this case, sitting there, the students start saying it's not ready, it's not there, etc. So I think teaching assistants particularly should stay on top of making sure that whatever has been made ready has also been released in time. And also, Andrew mentioned, you know, small details like typo, this, that. So I think teaching assistant role there is the most critical.
Yeah.
You are the one who will have the time to really look at it carefully. Because it will be 95% or 99% ready. That 1% which makes the difference between it being on schedule, looking good, etc., and being, you know, not on schedule, not available, etc., that 1% is in your hands.
Yeah.
So please make sure that, you know, this Monday morning, if you are teaching a student for the course,
personally take it up that Monday morning, just check to make sure that it is public, that particular week's content has become public. And if there's some small three-line write-up about that set of lectures that are there, just read through it once to make sure there's no error in it. And also, if the assignment has to be uploaded, make sure it's uploaded and check the answers. Just check the answers.
It's not much prior.
Yeah, yeah, much before, not on Monday morning.
But that day you have to cross
sure, sure.
Otherwise, I think sometimes it just comes on the portal.
Yeah, there's a notepad and pen in case.
So that teaching assistant works very good.
Yeah, so many times you find teaching assistants, you may have exams on Monday, you have classes that day, you're busy. So Sunday night is also fine, but we don't want to have it delayed beyond that Monday morning 9 o'clock because after that they start sending us mails saying, but it has not come up yet or something. So
it's
even a half day before, a few hours before is fine for us, but no delay in the publishing of the content.
Yeah, even Saturday is okay. I mean, it's fine. I mean, whenever you have time, but do
this,
plan it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
This time, I don't know, I proposed one for my two courses. I had made a questionnaire, bullet points, which is having a Google Sheet, which will ask certain questions. Is the course content available to you? Audio clear, video clear? Course coverage is comfortable? Questions answered properly? The discussion forum is active. Questions answered what time lapse? All will be answered for all participants. I am giving a rating. So if the rating goes down below the previous week, I have to ask my TES to make a meeting and say why this happened.
Okay.
I made a review sheet this time, so this will be floated every week. You will get a feedback directly. I am not getting it back. It will come to input the coordinates directly.
Okay.
So you will know that where or what I am doing on last week.
Okay.
So if there is a depression in that ranking, then I think there should be a meeting.
Okay.
So if this is followed, it will be very good.
Yeah. In fact, you can also make it as part of your online course content itself. Below every video week's lectures, you can have some questions posted, no? They do that. They do that. Below that, you can have questions. In the portal itself, you can set up those questions. So, they'll see the video and then below that, they can answer those questions without going into another sheet. It's possible. I mean, let's see.
So, Andrew, do we upload the assignment for the week along with the material or is
yes.
the assignment uploaded later?
Yes, along with the material. Uh-huh. Everything is released on that Monday morning.
And 15th, all the content in every course should be on the portal.
Yeah. So the ideal way to do it is to make sure all the content is already there before the course starts.
Yes.
Till Jan 15th. And in the portal, there is a way to make the content public. That's all. Everything is already uploaded and kept in private mode.
Yes.
And on Monday morning, you're simply making it public. You're not really creating content or anything at that point. That is the best way to run the course. It's the least stressful way. Everything is there. You're just making it public. Perfect way to run it.
One more thing I would suggest, I mean, more for TAs from my experience last time. It's very useful if you can solve the problem.
Oh, yeah.
There have been a couple of cases where two TAs were able to solve and remaining TAs were not able to solve. And what that feedback that gave me was that the number of problems that are of the difficulty level that I expect are higher than what I have promised.
Yeah.
And that helps us really pitch the course properly. So.
I think so. For not only that, I think being able to solve at least one of the TAs solving the problem and then entering the solution and checking. Is absolutely important. Otherwise, things can go wrong. You would have maybe done it correctly, some setting somewhere would be wrong. Once something goes wrong, it's impossible to correct it. So ideally, the way you should run it is, before the thing goes public, before the assignment goes public, you have to make sure that the answers are checked correctly or not. I mean, there is a way for TAs to log in and then put in the answers and check whether all the answers are correct or not. I think that has to be done, definitely done. And then when you release it for public, you can stop it. You don't have to have the check answers option enabled. So there is something called a check answers option for every assignment. You can keep it enabled, check it, and then disable it, and then make it public, so that students are not able to do it, but at the same time they do. So this is
small clarification. For example, Monday, how many hours of course content should be uploaded? For example, let's say 36 hours. I have a 50 hours class.
Okay.
It is much more than 36 because I am not able to cover it in 36 hours.
Okay.
So should I divide the n by n number of weeks and upload them all in upfront?
Yes, whatever content.
Or should I grow gradually? Let's say 5 in the first week, then 6 in the second week, gradually. How do you do? Because the question is, the more you upload, the less you will see the registration for the exam.
Yeah, that's also true.
The other model that we had in some courses was, you course, if it's possible in your course, is you have maybe 40 hours or 35 hours which is applicable for the exam, if you can split it that way, and say this is additional content for this course which we are not going to use, but those who are interested in this information be really useful, you know, if the course
yeah.
can be split like that, that
so you can reduce the content which is for the exam. That has been very popular, but everything is there.
Yeah.
I mean, so people, interested students will see it. But for the exam, you focus on these things. Some additional topics, you have to split it like that. If you can do that, then that also helps. So students know there's about 2 or 3 hours of content every week, which they have to really focus on. The other things they can do in a more relaxed way without the stress of preparing for the exam.
Another common thing which I had in my discussion forum is, we have given about 60 to 70 references, textbooks, etc.
They are
not accessible to
yes.
people outside IIT or any IIT system.
Yes.
Do they have to, can we create an hyperlink to this through our internet library?
Yeah, there are a few public resources that are in India being created now. One is the Digital Library Project of IIT Kharagpur. It's probably we can link to that if they have it available. The other is InfLibNet. InfLibNet also has a huge amount of content which is all free for people in India. There are a few efforts like that, but which college would know it? You know, I mean, even in IIT, many people don't know it because we anyway have access. But outside, we can work with you on that. But it's really good to have resources that are open, for which they don't have to pay for.
Now, what I mean to specifically ask is, let's say IIT Madras library has got certain textbooks.
Oh, you make it available to them, at that time.
Yeah, as if they are IIT students.
Okay.
Is it possible? Is it allowed?
Right now, we haven't explored that. No. Not for books.
For example, all books of IIT Madras library are easily accessible to the MBTL portal.
I'm not sure if that's necessarily a good idea, because I would want my research scholars to get priority over.
I mean, how do you make it available? First of all, they have to come here and see.
No, soft copy is there. All are e-books.
Okay,
all are e-books.
E-books
these days. Most of the contents are e-books.
We'll work with InfLibNet first. I think InfLibNet also has a huge cache of e-books.
Because research papers, journals are difficult because they are all priced publication.
Mm.
But e-book contents in the present domain, it is more in a liquidized mode.
We can try that.
Thank you. I have a very slightly different problem, because the course which I offer are, of course, you know my subject.
Yeah.
Entirely.
Hmm.
And the colleges which function as Norrell, whatever,
yes.
they don't offer such courses, and I find hardly any takers from their list of students. So I have to find my students.
Yeah, sure.
I have to go to them.
Yes.
So my idea is that last time I did it in a small way through social media and all, but you said, you know, advertising is not.
No, I mean, we can. I mean, social media and all is fine. I don't think the ministry even understands
that.
So they won't do much.
But this time, in fact, yesterday I wrote to her. You know,
we do have all those avenues. We have a Facebook account in which
and
you can build marketing.
This time, what I'm planning to do is, if possible, to prepare a brochure of 2 or 3 courses which disciplines, similar disciplines, people offer. And send it to some colleges.
Definitely.
Which are basically arts colleges.
Yeah, definitely.
And
sure.
Of course, universities as well.
Sure.
So that is
sure.
the way you can, I mean, I want to reach them because the kind of feedback which I get now is when you have your lectures in the YouTube, you download it and below you can see the comments.
Yeah.
That itself is a great satisfaction.
Yeah.
So
sure.
I basically do it for that, but at the same time, when there is a possibility that students can enroll
sure.
and get a certificate, that might be an additional
sure.
Encouragement for
sure.
the motivation.
Sure, we're happy to do that, no problem.
So that's the reason why I said, I need a little more time to prepare and thanks.
Okay, so in terms of recording, if at all possible, I would say, I mean, I think right now most of you have probably already finished recording. It's not something we can revisit too much, but in case you're doing some recording, it comes out much better on video. The resolution and all is high. If you write, say, on a tablet as opposed to writing on the board, everything changes a lot when you write on a tablet. You can use slides, you can mark those slides if you like. All of that you can do. Another very interesting thing a lot of students appreciate is if you do videos which are not just lectures. Yeah, so this is a slide on improving the course videos. A lot of feedback we get from people outside is they don't really have access to good labs, good lab facilities in the area that you're talking about. Can we have videos of how a good lab looks like? What are some good experiments you can run? Some good demos that you can show them just to, you know, in one way it breaks the monotony of lectures coming in. In another way, it just exposes them to how to even set up labs. In fact, apparently, a commonly said thing is a lot of kids, they buy, and they, in most cases, they don't know how to use, and then it, all this ends up being a big problem. So you can, if you can show, I mean, our studio is very, very much available to you, our people are available to you, you can take them to your labs, you can show them around how you set up things, some interesting experiments, maybe some demonstrations, or even outside, if you think there is some industry or something which is actually doing one of the things that you're teaching, you want to show them some actual footage of how that works, we're very happy to help out. All those things have a great impact on how everything works. And the other thing people pointed out are, you know, the intro videos, introduction videos. People are saying it's good to have it done in a better way. We are trying to put some things in place, but I don't know how much we can improve there. But there are some nice introduction videos that we have seen. We can point you to it. You can write to us. We can show you some of these very nice videos that were done for a few other IITs have done it. Nothing here has been so good. So, I mean, in case you have a nice idea for an introductory video which you think will really capture the essence of your course, we're happy to work with you and do that. Another idea that I would suggest to make your course a bit more broad-based is many of us go to industry and maybe other colleges and give popular lectures. These are not very rigorous, deep lectures like we do inside our IITs for courses. Bit of a lighter introduction, high level, covering a lot of ideas in some time. I'm sure you have slides like that. So you can present that maybe midway through the course or in the beginning of the course, maybe every 2 weeks or so, just to bring up a high level introduction to what is going on and then in-depth view. So those are all ideas that that we are suggesting. So some colleges, so those are how to make the course videos more lively, etc. If you think your videos are already lively, then there's nothing more to do. It's great. But then one issue a lot of colleges point out, particularly these Board of Studies meetings, when they want to do credit transfer, they really want to know how many hours of engagement the student had every week. And here, the number of hours of course video plays a big role. So, I mean, you know how the Board of Studies are. There's so many different colleges and different types of people who are there. So, if you do, say, a 20-hour course, when the number of course videos is actually 15 hours, then that becomes a problem for them. Because the Board of Studies has approved a 20-hour course, and finally, when they want to credit it, it's a 15-hour course. It doesn't work for them. It might seem like a very silly thing, but that's how, unfortunately, these things work, the letter of the law works. So, if you do an 8-week course, try to make sure your content of video is greater than or equal to 20 hours. It just helps. I don't know why. It's a little bit administrative at some level, but that's how things are set up here. It works that way.
Things that can be used for justification, I don't know what it can be. Sometimes you want people out to search for sources.
Hmm.
That's fake time.
Hmm.
For example, if I go out to a media, it's about 5 minutes.
Yeah, sure. Sure. So that's all they want. I mean, at some point, you should be able to say, this is the amount of hours of engagement the student had based on all the content I had. So if we are able to produce a document like that, they're happy to have it.
So are you putting it on the course intro page, you're thinking or something like that? Like
yeah.
How many hours a student has to spend every week?
Every week, yeah. If we can, yeah. So we'll get back to you on that if you can give us some numbers on what you think is
so
there every week.
Wanted us to share something like
yeah.
that. So that
So all of those Board of Studies meetings makes a difference that NPTEL said it.
Yeah.
As opposed to the faculty themselves saying it. So we have to, it's good
but
for us to
how
say.
Do they calculate the credit? It is just like a viewing hours or the students need to put effort to understand or effort the books, read it? Or
it changes depending on who the Board of Studies is. And then I think in many places, I know a place where they take our 8-week course for 3 credits. And there are also places where the 8-week course is only 2 credits. And that's up to the university and the Board of Studies. We can't really influence that. We can simply say, this is the number of hours per week of engagement I expect from a student. This is what would have happened in this course. That is something we say, and then let them decide how to convert that into credit. Because some colleges feel, you know, this content, while you might say is only 2 hours, 2 hours of video took 4 hours for an average student in our university. So this is big enough, so we are willing to give 3 credits. That's the kind of input they have for them, how they interpret. Okay, so yeah, like I said.
I have a question.
Yes. We should include the time for assignments as well. Definitely we should include the time for assignments. Yeah, so, okay. So like I said, most important part is release content regularly, and being active on the forum is also very important, answering questions on the forum. And the question paper has become a big deal now, because a lot of people are writing it, it's become very visible, and the scale is increasing. Question paper has become a big deal. It needs to be more standardized. We cannot make question papers like we do for our on-campus courses. It cannot happen just like that. Because you have to think about it. You have to, I mean, I've never been a big fan of this term, but you have to go to Bloom's taxonomy and you have to have certain fraction of questions which are of different type. And you have to have that, because this has become more or less a some sort of a standardized exam for a lot of people to take across the country. And you cannot target really one set of students. It's just not possible. We can't write it like that. So we have guidelines for it. We have detailed guidelines on what fraction of questions should be recall, what fraction of questions should be repetitions from the assignments, what fraction of questions should be new, as in which involves slightly more thinking than what was done in class. So all three are important. So in fact, there was a question paper where it was mostly recall, and students came back to it after it with a big complaint. Said, this is not an IIT course. We expected something a little bit more challenging. You can't ask very basic questions like this. You can't let us go in half an hour. You know, you have to engage us for the full time of the exam. So it needs to be challenging, but we've also had the other extreme where faculty members have simply repeated the IIT Madras question paper. And then that reflects very, very badly. Nobody really passes the course. I mean, that's also not what we want. So we have given detailed guidelines on how many questions, of how many marks, what fraction should be basic recall from the lectures, what fraction should be repetitions from the assignment. So you might say, why are we repeating from the assignment? Isn't that bad? But in this context, it's very important, because we don't know who did the assignment. If you repeat from the assignment and they do well in those questions, we know that they know how to do the assignment. For sure, because this is in a proctored condition, that's very important. So it's perfectly fine to repeat, and it's important that you repeat questions from assignment. Of course, you can change numbers, that's okay, but you have to repeat the questions from the assignment. That's very important. And then you should also have one component which is different. They may be similar to the assignment question, but different enough that it will test whether the concepts have sunk in or not. So all these three are important. We have detailed guidelines. We'll give you those guidelines once again. And the other important thing is, we want the question paper tomorrow.
Tomorrow?
I'm just kidding. As very early. So 15th January is our date. So a lot of people ask, how can I give you a question paper without even seeing the start of the course? Okay. So I know it sounds like a very unreasonable request, but you have to imagine there are 130 courses that are going to come. And all the question papers from 130 faculty, two question papers each, have to be processed at one office here. It needs to be converted into a format which goes into the TCS system. Now, that's not an easy task. Okay, so for those of you who are familiar with the GATE process, you know how complicated it is. Okay, and GATE can afford to do it because they run only one exam a year. We run four exam days, two exams on each day every year. So that's a huge task. And GATE does not have 130 question papers. It's all much, much lesser. And they work slowly, carefully over a long period.
So, yes.
Andrew, are these question papers supposed to be MCQ or?
We will give you detailed guidelines, and you can follow those guidelines. Both are possible. Both are possible. You can have objective type as well as subjective type, which are paper pen written, and you evaluate them. Both are possible. We will give you detailed guidelines on how that works. So now, the Jan 15th question paper is not set in stone. I mean, we expect a large part of those question paper to remain the same. But after you run the course, if you feel like there are, you know, really I want to go change it, it's okay to change. But having the first question paper out, I think, is extremely important. Please do work on it very early and give us the papers by Jan 15th, because we have a long process after that. And it will help us tremendously.
For example, January 15, the course is open. 1 week you leave, let us first play one assignment, get the feeling of the student, first hand touch, then we give the paper, maybe 22nd.
So
you have to give us 1 week at least to
know. No, actually course starts on 23rd.
So then you have to give you till 30th. So at least we will know at least one assignment should be born.
Okay, just one thing. The question paper actually consists of three sections. We have even given the breakup of the sections the way we want the format. So there is a section 1, 2, 3 ideally. So we have it, the first part, it's called recall from the course. So you know already what contents you've done, there's recall. Second is the online assignments which we are either duplicating or very similar lines. So at least if those
two are ready,
which is like 50% marks of the total, then it's fine. The third part is where we say that you can play around with what extra you want to ask them or something. So that also, if you have an idea, it's fine. That can be tweaked. But if the first two can be kind of finalized, then for us working with it is much easier. So that is something that we can do.
These problems become more complicated when the question paper is an MCQ type. I mean, am I right?
Yes.
Yes.
If it is a subject, let's say pen writing mode, I think this is not a big problem, is it not?
It's but not then, very serious.
32,000 depends on the course and how many numbers are going to be writing it.
Yeah.
So if it's a smaller
If the numbers go up, then you have to go back to the objective type.
And the post processing for the faculty, the numbers are huge, is also dependent. Oh, correct answering and
genius. Yeah, that's commitment from his side. if he agrees to do an MCQ, then it's fine. If he agrees to do a paper pen mode, what are going to be the numbers?
So what we have specified is for the online and offline exam, the structure is going to be the same.
Yes.
We are saying by Jan 15th, you can give us the paper.
So I let me step back a little, because if there were only 5 faculty we are working with, we are happy to relax the deadlines. Now that the number has gone to 130 across institutes, so many different people, we have to first put down some deadlines which are very serious.
Yeah.
And of course, you know, depending on people who have a lot of experience in this, we will work with you. I'm not saying we won't work with you. It's fine. But still, please try to think of the question paper. Basically, it means you have to start thinking right now about what you're going to ask. What would make sense, etc. So that's what's very important.
I'll also add that, you know, sometimes we have to get back to the technique because something they have overlooked in the paper. I mean, maybe something which today sounds trivial, but you know, we have people send us the multiple choice question paper where maybe the answer is already marked on the question paper. Something like that, which they have had some other idea. They are thinking that, you know, we will deselect the answer and then they will do some. Maybe that was their idea or some such thing.
The key is also
some
given.
Specific errors are there, which we need some time to, you know, catch, run through it and check if you know, it's not having those errors. And then move it.
Or you expect some type of answers that the student would key in, but the software will not accept that. So then we check it and we get back to you saying this is not possible in the system, we want to rework it. There are some questions where there are huge things which we wanted to break up. So we don't advise 10 mark questions. The maximum marks that any question can have, he says 3 or 4, because we don't want the student to lose out too many marks when he's going in for an online. So then if the faculty comes back with a 10 mark question, we send it back and say, you know, now break it down either into steps or give us more questions. So we need time for us to go a few times back and forth and kind of finalize it.
And also, you know, sometimes they would have said you have used some data from some data sheet. And because it's in campus, we would be naturally providing it in the hall, exam hall or something. But here we have
they
to
may not
make
get
sure
it,
that
yeah.
we get the data sheet from the thing. So we need little time to run through that.
And there's so many various different subjects, and it just takes much, much longer than you can imagine. So, given the process, I'd really like to. Okay, so I think so. You will get feedback at the end of the course, and it's important to incorporate the feedback. And we also collect video feedback from the people who write the exam. So, I think that's also a good we will share it with them also. Okay, so I think those are the slides. Now, I think I would like to. Look at the, I think these documents have been given to you.
Yeah.
You do it? Okay. So, Bharti is going to go through some of that document in some detail and walk you through what to pay attention to. I think the main thing I want to emphasize once again is the visibility level has gone up significantly, and people get upset when something is not done properly. So, I think I would really urge you to be more diligent, and Monday morning, I'll definitely urge all the faculty to check the content that is out there. Check for typos, because these typos are, I mean, they might sound silly to you, but it really reflects badly on everybody if it's not there. And definitely faculty you are responsible. That let me make that part also very clear. Even though we have teaching assistants, just like IITM policy, you are definitely responsible for every content, every question being correct, everything being correct. Ultimate responsibility definitely stops with you. So I would request you to be more diligent and look at the
content. One more selfish reason. So there was an error, for example, in one of the questions that I had. And literally within an hour of releasing the solution, 100 emails.
Yeah.
So you really get swamped. So it's very useful to do this beforehand rather than.
Yeah. So it's very, very important. It's
all of you must know we get two kinds of emails. When there's a mistake, they'll say, "How can IIT do such a thing?"
Yeah.
And when something can't be done, we start to say, "IIT can do anything." You know, how can you say no to this? So we get two types, which are, you know, broadly in this.
So people out there, the perception is that there is a certain perception of IITs. You know what it is, and so we have to live up to that. I think whether you like it or not, we have to live up to it. And any mistake is highly amplified. Believe me, mails go out to the Prime Minister with a copy to us saying this is what's going on. So it just happens. So, and again, perception matters a lot. I think we had a meeting with Professor Bhaskar where also he said apparently perception is reality today. So it really matters a lot. So let's work doubly hard to make sure that there are no errors and we don't get embarrassed in public.
But just a query, is it the case that that MHRD has taken all the recorded video and airing in some of the channels?
Yes, there is a channel called Swayam Prabha, which is a DTH channel. If you have the Doordarshan set-top box, you can set it up in your house also and then show. I mean, we have set it up here. You can see the DTH channel, a channel that's coming out. Oh, that's on Swayam. Okay, on Swayam. So Swayam, I'll give updates later on. Right now, you can wait for me. Yeah. Yes, you can ignore it for now. We will get back to you with more details. Well, you are registered. Yes, yeah, through our office, and we are working in some way carefully to handle it. There's no major hurry right now, but hopefully sometime in January I'll get back to you with more details. So ICSR is going through a modernization process. It's been going through that for the past 6-7 years. Hopefully they'll complete it within a year or so. And believe me, I mean, if you think that's a pain, we deal with them every day. So like I can tell you horror stories. So please bear with us.
Okay, we've given you 4 documents. I'll send the soft copies also to the TAs as well as the faculty on this. First thing, we'll be creating a Google Groups of the faculty members so that we can send out common announcements to all of you. TAs also will be creating a Google Groups on which all of you will be there, for which we have collected the email IDs. If there's anything missing, please add it up there. So you should start seeing emails from us like within this week, I guess. So the first sheet that I'm having is the pre-course sheet, which is called NOC Process and Course Builder Workshop, that one. We have the timelines there. So we have 3 sets of courses starting on 23rd January. I think most of your courses are going in there, except for probably 1 or 2. The exam dates are on 26th March for that. So the first 2 set. And then we have another set of courses starting in February, so which will be the 4-week, 8-week, again a new set that we are starting, and there will be another exam date in April for which that set will go for exams. Course contents, yes, we have just specified, this is the general run through I'm giving, a minimum of 2.5 hours, you can exceed it, but again we recommend don't exceed too much because most of the people doing... Yeah, most of the people doing the course are either professionals or students in colleges and they're doing it as an extra add-on. So, I mean, overloading them too much, we don't recommend, but yes, you can see how much content you want to push out every week. Then for each video, we require a summary of the video with 3 or 4 points below the video. This is really useful because then it says what the video is about, what are the salient points being dealt with in that particular video. So please, this is kind of mandatory now. Just see that you have 3 or 4 points below the video saying what it is about. And provide notes or slides wherever possible. So if you've taught using slides or you have taught using, say, a tablet, make it available so that it becomes like course notes for him. Also for courses
even if
that...
it is handwritten notes, it helps. You have a neat hand in
the tab format, which is in journal.
Yeah,
that can be shared.
PDF file, no?
Yes, that can be shared.
Can also be made.
So when you send it out, kindly write protect it because people use it for textbook publication later. So write protect it so that at least copy protection is there.
Not
no, people do that. I have seen that. So.
Okay. So.
The summary of the video, the points inserted now in the video, because we have already made the video.
Below the video, on the online courses portal, we have a place where you can put in a few points about the video. Yeah. Make a summary, make notes available wherever it is there. For courses that have been offered previously, we are getting them transcribed now through our transcription partner. We will make these notes available to you. It should be available, say, by next month at least. If the TAs can verify, it will have mistakes. We only get a 70% to 80% accuracy in that. And if you can verify the transcripts as it comes in and also put it out as course notes, it's really helpful to the students. We get a lot of feedback saying that's a nice part, because when they want to revise for the exams, it's easier for them to go through the notes rather than videos. So we'll share the transcripts with you. The faculty can either directly verify the transcripts or have any of the students do it, and there's a separate honorarium for that too. So that can go in as part of the notes. One tutorial. Yes.
The transcripts from the video, like say
transcripts of your video, yeah, whatever you have spoken
given on the board.
Yes, so the math part will come as
whatever you spoke.
Oh, okay.
Whatever you spoke, it's done.
There'll be snapshots of your board work in the transcript given, and whatever you have spoken will be out in letter format. So we just need a math conversion for that into formulae kinds. So that is there. Then assignment, we require solutions to all the assignments. In many courses, we have to chase up for the solutions. This time we're making it mandatory. Solutions are there on the portal along with the assignments. Of course, not made public till the assignment closes. On the day that the assignment closes, please make public the solutions to the assignments. So if you're giving out problems, please see that there's a completely worked out format of the problems rather than just giving answers or values, because they might not know how to solve it. Or a video can be done. Some of the TAs or the faculty have even done videos showing how you solve the assignment. So one of these two is a mandatory requirement now. Post. Yes, sir.
Assignments also, can I have descriptive type answers?
Yes, you can have, sir, but then you'll just have to check on numbers and how to evaluate it.
So
yes.
What we suggest is, this is a good method. First week or so, you do only objective type and see how many people are responding. Once the number becomes reasonable that you're confident you can handle, then you can do subjective type descriptive.
The difficulty is, Andrew, in subjects like ours.
I know it's very hard, but then first week is just assessing who all are there in the course. So you can ask some simple recall type.
Sometimes, you know, sometimes they themselves are comfortable, more comfortable
But the first week you go with subjective, and supposing you have 2,000 subjects.
No, that I'm not in any way expecting. Yeah. I'm so confident about that.
Okay. But I would really suggest that the first week.
All our Madras courses should be open for enrollments today. We've already opened about 15 or 20 yesterday. Totally in Madras, IIT Madras handling, we have about 30 courses, I think.
This is about the Jan course.
Yes.
Yes. No, even for your course, it's opening. We'll say that it starts on February and the enrollment will be open till February. So we have opened all the IIT Madras courses. The mails are going out to the faculty, giving the user admin ID and the passwords. We still haven't reached out to the TAs using the admin ID and passwords. Please contact your faculty members to get the admin ID and passwords. The next step is, we have put out information on the course introductory page based on the syllabus submitted. It has been done humanly. We are opening 30 courses at a time, checking other institute. Prone to errors, there is going to be some of it. So please go to your individual courses, check that the data put out on that page is all correct. So we have about the course, intended audience, prerequisites, any industries that recognize it, about the course instructor, photograph of the instructor. Below that is the course layout, and then we have any suggested readings that you might have. Then we have certification data. Data also available. So kindly check that the dates that we have put in there are correct, the exam dates are correct. If yours is an 8-week course, we have put in March. If it's a 12-week, we have put in April, and so on. And all the other information, this is completely editable by you. So once you have shared the admin ID and the password, you get access to the dashboard. Dashboard is the back end of the course that we call it, from where you can control all this. You can go and change in whatever you require. Okay? It is. We'll show you. We'll share some videos with you. The dashboard has changed. For people who have used the previous dashboard, the dashboard has now changed. We have a version upgrade now. Not significantly different, but yes, certain things have been moved around. You just need to search for maybe a few minutes and you'll get there. So that can be done, and you can change it correspondingly. The other thing that you can customize, we have done two more things. One is in the announcement section. We have already put out an announcement so that people coming there will see something there. Forum, we have put out a post called Introduce Yourself, just to get the forum started. And many people do enthusiastically introduce themselves, saying who they are, why did the course, and so on. TAs can introduce yourselves there. Please put saying that you'll be supporting the course and so on. TAs can also, we would recommend, and it's nice when we have some TA photos in the course. For instance, one of the courses, I think we already have a TA photo on who's going to be supporting it. Y'all can check with your coordinators, put out your photos and say you'll be the TA for this course handling it. It's nice to get a face there for, you know, they'll be getting a lot of replies from you. That's another thing. And there is a welcome email. So every student who registers gets a welcome email. Again, we have used our absolute standard format with data. If you want to change it, customize it, make it more friendly, or in whatever style you want, feel free to change it. Just keep the data intact. You can change any other things there. Yeah, so the check task that I've given, please go through that and see that you check all this information on the portal and it's correct, because people will come back and say that day you had put out this information. They'll have photographs on their mobile phones. They'll send it to us. It was there like this on the portal. Now you've changed stuff. So just see that all the information there is correct before we go live. Okay, that's done. Then we have during the course run, I'm just going to go quickly over that. Mostly it's there. Uploading videos on YouTube. So every admin ID that we give is a Gmail ID. It has a corresponding YouTube channel associated with it wherein the course videos are going. For courses that are getting rerun, we are just using IDs from the previous run. We are not doing new uploads unless there is new content to be uploaded. So for the rerun courses, we have imported the course, that is we have cloned it already. Every link is available. You just need to reorganize it and change it whatever you want, delete stuff that you don't want and so on. For the new courses, we need to upload content. So get in touch with our studio team, with our office, to get the uploads done of the new videos, and we can start creating content unit wise, week wise and so on. So some recommendations we have given here. This is more for the TAs. It'll be nice if you can go through it. For instance, we want something like week-wise organization of contents is really nice. Then it gives a student of, you know, which week he has he studied, which week has not studied. So do week one with a unit name, what it deals with, then lesson names. And please do not use lesson one, lesson two, lesson three. It makes no sense. So give some name to what the concept is about. Maybe call it lesson one hyphen something. Put something in there so that he knows, you know, what that particular link is about. So that is something. Assignments. This is again another thing that there's too much variation. We are kind of standardizing it now. Have a module called assignments probably, okay, and publish your assignments in there. And solutions also come out in the same module. We've seen solutions come out in the announcement, solutions come out in the forum, solutions put out in somewhere, some other link, and we are not able to find it. I hope the students find it. So kind of standardize the whole thing. You'll have the course outline, you'll have a module called assignments. Within the assignments, release the solutions as they come out. It's easy for everybody to find it so that we know what's happening. And assignments, we'd like to put in one more thing here. Assignments are normally archived along with the solutions on the NPTEL website for anybody who wants to refer to the course in the future. So even once the course is over, all the contents are archived on the NPTEL website. Please have a copy of the assignments you are creating so that you can hand it over to us at the end of the course. Many times we hear from the TAs, I directly created on the portal, it was in my notebook. We don't get a copy at all for archiving. Please have a copy in some PDF format that you can share with us later on that we can archive. Okay. And configuring the marks, I've given some details there. Please get back to us if you have any doubts in configuration and everything. Checking of the assignments is most important. We get a lot of issues there when it's wrongly configured. Marks go on to 200, 300 and so on when, weightages and things are changed like that. Minus 200 if you do negative marking. We recommend don't do negative marking in assignments. It's only for them to learn something and do something. The exam weightage is only 25% currently for the assignments. So if possible, if preferable, and if you can convince the course instructors or the course instructors already here, if it's okay, do not give negative markings for the assignments. We'll just go with positive. So check the assignment when you put in answers. See that you get 100% for all correct, a 0 for all incorrect answers, partial marks according to what we've done. These are the checks that you will do when it is configured. We've given more details here. Please go through that on how to do it. We've given also the type of assignments that can be done. So basically we support MCQ, multiple choice questions, multiple select questions where you can have more than one answer. You can have short answers. That means in that you can have numerical and alphanumerical. Numerical, he can enter a number and that can be checked against. Alphanumeric, any words they can enter and that can be checked against. And the other type is the assignment, subjective assignment type. So these four that I've listed are auto-graded. You set the answer at the back end, it grades it automatically, it goes out as marks. For the subjective alone, we will require some configurations extra for people who will be correcting, for it to be allocated to them and so on, that have to be done before the assignment is made public. Not after, we cannot do it after that. So before the assignment is being made public, the subjective, we need to say who is going to correct the assignment so that it gets allocated to them. And then we'll get access to the assignments for grading. Another thing that we have seen in the past is when subjective assignments are going out, the grading doesn't happen on time. So people, if you're using subjective assignments, we'd like to see that the assignments are graded within that 1 week same time, and the marks are also published on the portal. There's a way of doing it. So let's see that it gets done. Many times till the end of the course, we don't get the solutions out and that becomes a problem for us. Okay. The grading of subjective assignments will also be for 100 marks.
Descriptive,
yes. So grading for subjective assignments is also 100 marks. Objective, anything, the course builder automatically does it out of 100. Okay. During the course run, yes, the content will be done whatever Monday you do. The other important thing is when the content is being released every Sunday, Monday, whenever you all are doing it, please send out an announcement to the students saying that this week's content has been released, because many of them somehow wait for the content. They think content will come into their inbox, content will come somewhere, it will be delivered to their house. I don't know, they'll write to us, where do I go find my content? We'll say go to the portal, log in, you'll see your content there. So send them an email on how to access it also. And in the subject, mention the course name. There are many people who are then 5 or 10 courses and you say this week's content released. Which course are we talking about? What is the content release? So in the subject name, always mention your course name and then go with whatever you have to say to the student. The other thing that we do is normally we archive all the contents as the course run goes on the NPTEL website. This is for the benefit of the people who cannot access YouTube. Many colleges have blocked YouTube access, and the online courses portal we use actually sources the videos from the YouTube. So this has been a request. So what we do is every Monday when your content goes live on the portal, we also make it live on NPTEL website. So week 3 content is live on the portal, week 3 content will be live on NPTEL website for download. It is available for download in 4 formats: MP4, FLV, 3GP and MP3. That is the audio rip we'll also give them just for the sake of listening if they want to do it. One check that we'd like the TAs to do is go to our NPTEL website. There is a course created for every equivalent course. Please check that the contents are correct. Sometimes what happens is the video may be replicated, or it's all done humanly, okay? There's not much automation being done. We are on the way to it. But just check that the videos are correct. If there are 5 videos in your portal, we also have 5 here, or we've not missed anything. Just do that one check and get back to us if there are any errors in it, okay? So that's something that you can check. And check the forum every day. So that's something, maybe once or twice depending on the traffic you have in your forum, keep replying to them. One thing we'd like to tell the TAs, we do tell it every time, is just be polite on the forum. These are people who have never probably been on an online course. First time they're getting into an online course, they are already hesitant to write because it's IITs they're addressing. They don't know English. They have a hesitancy in using the language. So sometimes, we are very used to that kind of thing, right? Okay, already done, already answered. It seems okay for us when we read it. But for a student from outside, when he sees such a reply, it's not very nice. You know, it may not kind of encourage him to post a query the next time, saying that, you know, what am I posting? So kind of be more encouraging. If your forum is kind of slackening, see what you can do to activate it. See how you can get the people to respond. Maybe you can recognize some people who are doing responses on your favor. Like, actually, and many times the people think that the forum is for students to interact with the faculty. They do not understand that they can also talk amongst themselves. They can also answer some questions. So maybe you can bring it about saying that anybody can answer anybody's questions, you know, and start a discussion. It's not like it's with the faculty. That's the main thing, but also to encourage discussion. So something like that you can try for the forum. On the forum, we also have certain features which are deleting junk posts. You can ban a user in case he starts publishing solutions, or if he's viewing being abusive or anything in that sense. You can mark duplicates. That is, many people are asking the same question. You can mark it as already answered. You can say it's a duplicate question that he can refer to some other question. You can tag best answers there to say that this person has answered the best answer. So all these options are available on the forum. Just explore it. And there's an email ID, the admin ID they will also be writing to. So please make it a point to check that admin email ID every day for any emails that have come there that you'll be responding to. Any admin related questions regarding the exams, regarding certificates, regarding thing, we will send you updates. So for the offices to handle the admin related across 130 courses is a little hard. We do try to keep be on top of it. So we'll send you whatever admin related answers you might be requiring. Use it. In spite of that, if you have any questions you don't know how to answer, please pass it on to us. We'll do it for you. Okay. For the faculty, we'd recommend that there's something called a daily digest from the forum that you can subscribe. So you can, the forum, what happens is you're not directly subscribed to the forum by email. It's not an auto subscription. It's not an auto subscription. It only happens if you subscribe to it willingly. So faculty, what we recommend is there is something called a daily digest. You don't have to get every post as it comes in. Once a day or something, you can do a digest to see how many posts have come, how many people have responded and so on. And you can also respond through email. So if you just have an email on your mobile or something, you don't have to log into the portal. So I think Pratap and all used to use it extensively. He just gets onto his email and he keeps responding to it. And it will get posted in the forum as well as go as an email to the student, which is very convenient, you know, when you're doing it. So you can subscribe to the forum with your email ID, whichever you think need not be loaded or whichever you use. So that is something that you can do. The enrollment data we will share with you weekly, but it's also available on the dashboard as analytics, so you can also track what is the enrollment happening. Few things we encourage the TAs also is please share that these courses are happening on your Facebook pages, any other groups that you have, any other department pages that you have that you can access to, saying that, you know, tell your friends that these courses are happening, they can enroll so that they see it. Right? So this is the during the run of the course that you'll be doing, making the content live, putting out the assignments, checking on that. Any other things that you require, our office is open, so you can do that. The third part that definitely we'd like to talk about is the question papers. So this is a little detailed here. You can go through it. So as sir was asking, there are two modes of examinations that we run. One is an online mode of examination, we call it, and a offline mode of examination. So online mode, both of these are proctored. Both of these, the students have to come to an exam center. Online doesn't mean that from home he can take it. Both of these, he has to come to the center. He has to register first in the form, pay the fee, get his hall ticket and appear. The only difference is in the online mode, it's very similar to our online assignments. So you can use only MCQ, MSQ, short answer type. Max, you can get one essay type which they provide. That is, you some answers can be written essay format that you can evaluate later on. But that is all it allows. Programming courses, of course, they have a programming platform. You can use C, C++, so on, if your course requires it. But that is the capability of the online exam. In case you want derivations, you want some graphs to be used, you want some other charts to be used, you want detailed answers to be written, you have to go in for the offline method of examination. So both of these are available with us, but the format of the question paper is by and large the same as we have outlined in the second thing, which soft copies I'll be sending you to. So that will be again three sections. One is going to be recall, one is going to be assignment based, one is going to be what you want to test the person extra on based on the course. So this is it. So what happens once you'll send the question paper in is we just do a rain check on the total of the paper, the type of questions, the number of questions, any other typos that we catch there and so on, get back to you with suggestions on what can be improved, and we'll get back the final paper from you. Once we create the final paper on the TCS platform, that we will do from our office here, and you, we need the faculty member and or the TA to come and sign off on the paper, because again here that's a manual process. So we might have made errors in translating your actual paper into the software. So please see that these checks are done and they all are correct. A few minutes I'd like to take on here is for some things where we've had mathematical papers, there were about a few questions that were wrongly worked out and the answer options were incorrect. So they had gone in for an online exam, but the options given were totally wrong because the working out was wrong by whoever had done it. It had not been cross-checked. So if you're doing anything like that, please cross-check all the answers that are being given there, because post-exam we can't do anything except, you know, moderate or something which is not advisable. So kind of check all the answers given. In another question paper, we had 50 MCQ questions, all options are C. 1 to 50, the answer, correct answer is C. We couldn't change it too much, we had to go with it. So these are things we might want to avoid when we are designing the paper and we are looking at it. We see options being repeated in a question, we see questions being repeated in the question paper, 5 questions, 8 questions being repeated. The other thing we'd like to emphasize here is the 2 question papers that you give us should be identical in format. No extra questions, no lesser questions, no difference in the marks in the 2 question papers. They can only be different in questions. People ask us, can we repeat questions from question paper 1 to 2 because, you know, the content is so much and so on. This time we are having only one exam date, so morning exam and afternoon, which is better than last time which had a week's difference. So it is okay in a sense, but the thing is, after 1.5 hours, we start allowing students to go out if they finish the exam. So if they start doing that, there is a chance that your paper will be out in some social media forum somewhere. So the second group should not get an unfair advantage in the way the question paper has been designed, assuming that the first paper is totally out. So that is the way in which the questions can be repeated. So not many of them being repeated, but assuming this, please design your 2 question papers. So that is what we'd say. The other thing for, again, people from the past to now, the change that we have done is we have standardized the grading mechanism. There is, we are kind of tightening on, we are not giving the faculty leeway to decide on what is the mix of assignments to exams course. This was done due to various reasons. One is, initially it was much more flexible than we are now. Firstly, we have 130 courses. So if we have 130 different types of logic in which we are going to apply to every course, the colleges don't understand anything of it. You know, one we say best 3, best 5, best 8, this will not have assignments, that will have something else, 50 marks here, 70 marks there. So we kind of said, let's standardize it. What we have currently done is 25% of the total final score will come from the assignments, 75% will come from the certification exam. And how the 25% is going to be calculated is, for a 4-week course, it is best 3 out of 4 weeks the average will be, best three will be taken average and 25% from that. For an 8-week course, it is best 6 out of 8. For a 12-week course, it is best 8 out of 12. So this is what we are standardized. We are publishing on the portal. So we are not going to be changing this. What this again in turn means is we need to have definitely 4 assignments, 8 assignments and 12 assignments. There is no going back on that. Right? We are committing to them. We are taking this. So we are not going to say at some point, no, I could do only 5. I could do whatever it is. Please see that you put out an assignment every week based on whatever content is there. The difficulty level, the way you put the questions may be there. And that assignment also helps us track how many students are active in the course in one sense, because we get the number of submissions as well as the average score. So we know how many people are actually active, and it also forces them to watch the videos. That's another way of enforcing that, you know, they finished complete that week's content in that week because they have to answer the assignment. So this is something that we have standardized now. And the certification exam guidelines are, for the 4-week courses, the exam time is going to be only 1.5 hours. So the paper needs to engage the student for 1.5 hours. For the 8-week and 12-week courses, we are saying that the paper needs to engage them for 3 hours. Okay? The 4-week exam, the paper can be for 50 marks. 8-week and 12-week can be 100. Of course, 50 means you can have it as 100 too. We have given guidelines on the marks. So the section 1 is going to have 1 mark questions, section 2, 2 mark questions, and section 3, we have put 5 mark questions. But if you say, I want to have 100 1 mark questions, well and good, that is fine. But then you have to tell us how much of it is recall, how much of it is from the assignments. We want to know that we keep that fraction a constant. Okay, the format that we are given is a minimal format. You can cross it, you can exceed it, but not go below it. You cannot say, I will give 5 questions of only so much and that's it, you know. Unless it's a subjective paper where we can give marks for him for that. Not in an online objective paper, definitely. Yeah, both the questions must be exactly identical, and this we have done. NPTEL office will do all this minimum requirements, numerical. Yes, this time the other change that we're doing for people who have been with us before, for any question paper being submitted to us, we want a completely worked out solutions of that paper submitted to us again. This is just for us to check that, you know, somebody has worked it all out and the answers are correct there so that we know it. We just want the complete solutions, and a later date also if somebody says release it or something, we need to have the solutions with us. So we are asking for a completely worked out solutions to the question papers that you're going to submit to us. Yeah, certificate format and publishing, less than 40% final score, nobody gets a certificate. Then we have 3 categories of certificates, plus we are publishing the toppers also. So all those details I've given here, you can just check. This is more so for the TAs, because you'll get a lot of questions on, will I get so much, how many do I have to do, what, you know, what should I answer, will I get this certificate, that certificate, if I don't register, what can I do? The other common question you all may get is, if students are there registering into your course from abroad, what do? They can participate, enroll, complete the course, but currently we do not conduct proctored exams outside of India. Hence, unless they come to India to write an exam, they will not be getting a certificate. Okay, so you can tell them clearly you can be in the course, you can do it, but we will not be able to give you a certificate at present. We don't have that process in place. So I think that's it.
So I have one.
Yes, sir.
So for example, in my course, I don't expect large number of registrations. So if at all you are conducting an examination at the end,
yes.
I don't expect that it will split into two, like say morning and afternoon, because you know the number will be like say small. I don't know. I have no idea of guessing it, but I don't expect it to be a large number that okay. You have to split it into two.
Okay.
Even then, do you want 2 question papers, or I can give 1 paper in the beginning and?
So often, as people will write 2 subjects some of them on the same day.
Oh.
Okay. So, it's harder to manage. Let's go with 2 for
okay.
First.
No, just trying to see.
Fine. Yeah, the only point that we have in suggestions that best practice is not covered is that if the first week's content is available on the portal, you can open it right away.
Yeah.
So we recommend that, because students, it will give them a heads up in just going through. Even introductory video gives them an idea, but that's very generic, right? They're just listening to 3 minutes or 4 minutes of what you're talking. Put out a first week's content. That will help them decide how the course is going to be, what is the difficulty level. It gives them really, if they want to withdraw and enroll in some other courses, it is quite fine. So we'd say if your first week is available, make it public now and let them all handle it. And TAs can start handling forum. You will start seeing activity in the forum right away. Not too heavy, not too technical. But yes, you can say that you're there at least once a week. Just check and maybe give some replies to whatever they're doing there. Okay. I think we're done with this, so we'll send you all the emails out. Please be responsive to us. We work in a 3-month time frame and you know we are desperately trying to call you all or mail you all sometimes, expecting replies, waiting for you all to just, you know, getting some feedback and so on. Please do respond to our emails. Please, we will send you messages. Don't get bugged. Yes, we will bug you a lot. We will keep bombarding you with data and stuff. So kindly respond to our emails. Kindly adhere to the timelines that we are giving so that it's easy for us to work. And TAs definitely do respond to us. Many times we write on the group and we don't even know if you all have read it, not read it, what's happening. So be responsive to us as we write to you all saying this is happening.